Hello. So this should be a shorter video as there are a couple of things I want to show you, but that would be too long of a detour to put at the beginning of part 2, so let's call this part 1.5. Remember our weapon sheet? We made the description field a text area. This is workable, but there is a nicer way of doing this. Foundry has a handlebars helper called editor, which will generate a what you see is what you get editor, allowing you to add some formatting to text fields. As most input fields, you need to specify what it needs to display and which field of the model it needs to target. The button option allows you to choose whether the editor UI is always present or toggleable. Owner is important if the text contains secret, and editable is self-explanatory. Now, if I reload the world in Foundry and open the weapon sheet, we can see the edit button when we hover over the description, and if I click, something's wrong. The editor buttons are cut off and I can't see the text. One way we can investigate what's happening is with using the console. Like in Chrome, I can bring up the console by pressing F12. This allows me to inspect the HTML of the application and see what's what. But since there's a lot of stuff happening in the Foundry window, drilling down the HTML would be a tedious task. Thankfully, if I press Ctrl-Shift-C while in the console and move my mouse around, I can now see the various HTML elements as I hover over them. If I click on the editor section of the item sheet, the Elements tab of the console will now automatically highlight the corresponding HTML. Now I can go find the root element of our text editor. Down here in the console, there is a little window that shows us, among other things, the dimensions of the elements we have selected. And what do you know, this has a height of 17, which doesn't sound right. This is because in its default layout, the element will try to fit the content. And because the editor window doesn't contain the editor toolbar, you end up with a size that's wrong. I can actually change the height here, and if I do, we can see that now everything is fine. To fix this properly, we'll need to do some CSS. And that's the main topic of this video. When we set the system up, we define a style sheet named fs2e.css. We could go and create it and make the necessary changes, but we won't. I can guarantee you that this style sheet will become unwieldy very quickly, so to keep our sanity, we'll have to resort to using a CSS preprocessor and an automatic transpiler. It's a bit of work to set up, but you only have to do it once, and trust me, it's worth it. There are several offerings available, but I'll be using Less, mainly because that's what D&D 5e used, and I don't know any better. I'm not going to go into the details, but the main reason we're using this is to allow us to keep things organized. Doing this requires a bit of setup in VS Code, and there's a good tutorial on Visual Studio Code's website. So pause this video, go follow that tutorial, which I've linked in the description, until step 2 of automating SAS/Less compilation, then come back here. Okay, you're back? Cool. So our gulp file is going to be a bit different than the one in the tutorial, as you can see on the screen. I'm not going to spend time explaining how this all works, because I don't really understand it, but I will point out the important bits. What this bit does is take the file called fs2e.less in the folder called less, which we're going to create shortly, and then compile it into an fs2e.css file and place the resulting file in the base directory. So you'll need to replace fs2e with the name of your system, obviously, or whatever you said your style sheet would be called in the system.json. The second bit is going to look out for any changes to a .less file in the less folder and trigger the first command whenever something changes there. This will spare us most of the embarrassment of forgetting to run less whenever we make a change to our style sheets. Right, so let's give these commands something to work with. We're going to create a less folder, in which we'll create the fs2e.less file. All this file is going to do is import the other files we're going to create to split our style sheets into manageable chunks. So let's import a file called item-sheet.less that we'll immediately create in the same folder, but we'll leave that empty for now. Next, we need to run the gulp task for all that magic to happen. If I press Ctrl-Shift-B in Visual Studio Code, it will ask me which build task I want to run, and that's going to be gulp. Then we select never scan the output for this task. We'll have to do these two things whenever we restart Visual Studio Code. And this has now created an fs2.css file, which is currently empty, but we shall do something about this momentarily. First, we need to figure out what to put in. Let's go back to Foundry. If you remember at the beginning of this video, what we're trying to solve is the description editor height being too small in Weapon Sheet. To do this, we need the editor div to take all the available space in the form. This requires the parent container to take all the available space, which it currently doesn't. And this in turn requires changing the layout of the form element because currently it displays the content as blocks, which take as little space as possible. So first, we need to identify the div that contains the stats and the editor. Let's call this sheet-content. Now we can go into our item sheet.less and start styling. The main application window has a sheet class, so we're going to start there. Then we said we needed to change the layout of the form. We'll make it use flexbox and go vertically. This will allow the children elements to stretch and shrink as required. Then we need the sheet content to do the same, and also make its height 100% so that it will take all the available space. Finally, we need the editor to take all the space it can, so we set its height to 100%. By the way, this nesting of CSS rules is specific to CSS preprocessors like Less, and that's why they make offering style sheets so much more palatable. Here's what the generated CSS looks like for information. Anyway, with all that done, if I go back to Foundry, close the world and reopen it, the editor should now expand as we make the window bigger. I should mention that normally you don't need to close the world to get style sheets update. Refreshing the page should be enough. I think in this case it's getting confused because the CSS file was empty before. Okay, so now that this is resolved, we have two problems left to tackle. First, I have to make the window bigger every time and it's a bit annoying. Second, the CSS rules we put in place would apply for every sheet and we might not want that, but we don't have a way to identify that this is an item sheet. We can solve both these problems in one place. In our custom item sheet class, we can override a static getter function called default options. There, we can return an object with options such as the default size of the window in pixels, as well as CSS classes we want to attach to the window. I'm just going to set some sensible values for the size and add classes to identify the window as an item sheet, and I also add in a class for the system. Not necessary, but might come in handy if we need to tell things apart. MergeObject is a Foundry-specific helper function to make it easier to integrate our changes with those from the parent function, which we don't want to throw away. Back to Foundry. After a refresh, we can now see that the sheet starts taller, so I don't have to resize it. And if we look at the main element for the window in the inspector, we can see that it has the classes we've just added, which means that now I can go back to our style rules and modify them so that they only affect this sheet. And there we go. With the CSS setup out of the way, we can move on to building character sheets, which we'll do in the next video, where we'll also talk about the things to consider when writing a system for Foundry. See you in the next one.